know, we didn't know anyone other than our parents.
Right.
So at first it was my brother and I, and then my younger sister was born here. We didn't speak the language, we had no friends, so we just had each other, you know. So although, you know how siblings fight a lot, especially coming in from the Caribbean, where we had a big house and the patio and the entire neighborhood to run around. So then you come here living in a tiny apartment. Actually, when we first got here, my parents couldn't afford to pay rent for a full apartment, so they were renting one room. And then my sister was born shortly after us arriving here, so we had a family of five living in one bedroom. Not in one bedroom proper.
Now were you in Yonkers?
In one room, yes. I've always lived in Southwest Yonkers the entire time.
Okay.
So we were a family of five living in one room. The other rooms were rented to other people.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, so it was really hard. It was really hard, but at the same time, you know, it helped mold us into who we became.
Right.
Hardworking people, you know, it's just people who admire their family, admire their parents, admire and respect the sacrifices that, you know, their parents made. My parents made a big sacrifice leaving their country, leaving their homes behind, leaving their businesses behind, leaving their families behind, and coming here. They came here just a year ahead of us, just to sort of get themselves a little bit more situated.
I mean,
with our grandparents, yes, we stayed with our family, with our grandparents, and our parents were always writing us letters, phone calls. Back then it was a little harder and more expensive to stay in touch, so we had to wait every Sunday for a phone call from our parents. And then whenever someone would travel back and forth, we had to wait for a stack of letters. And then we sort of started a little trick up. Instead of just writing letters, they will record cassettes.
Okay.
Back then we had the cassettes.
That's right.
So they will record a bunch of like things, you know, and we love you so much, and we're working, and we're preparing this for you, and yada yada. So when we got the cassettes, because someone will travel, so they will bring the package of cassettes.
Right.
We would just sit there, the entire family, and my brother and I, and just press play, listen to cassettes, just to listen to our parents' voices. You know?
That's beautiful.
Yeah, it was great. I remember my mom saying in one of those cassettes, and over here, they have a machine that washes your dishes, and machine that washes your clothes, and we were like, oh my God! You know what I mean? Coming from the Caribbean, I love it. I wouldn't have it any other way. I mean, should I ever have any children in the future, I want them to know exactly where I came from, and I want them to have the same experiences as well.
Right.
Humble beginnings are incredibly important.
Absolutely.
And never forgetting where you come from, it's the best. It's the best thing ever.
Right.
Yeah, so I had the best childhood, you know, although the things were pretty much rudimentary, I had an incredible childhood, and I wouldn't change it for the world.
Did you go to the Yonkers public schools?
Yes, I did. So I came here at the age of 10. Again, I didn't speak the language, but my brother and I used to pretend we spoke English,
right.
So we say a bunch of jibber jabber, and the other kids would look at us like, is there something wrong with
it? They had this secret language.
Yeah, we had our secret language, so it was a lot of fun. So we both went to Enrico Fermi School. Back then it was Enrico Fermi School for Performing Arts. I still remember the school song, and sadly today there's no trace of the song. Luckily, just recently I went into the school to donate supplies for children and to the school itself. We donated back to school supplies to over 300 kids and supplies to the school, like art supplies and things of that nature. I found the yearbook, and the school song was in there, so I brought it back to them. I framed it and brought it back to them because I wanted to have the kids sing it. You know, it was a spirit.
Right.
Yeah, it was a spirit, so I still remember it. Edwin Quesada was impressed. He's like, how do you still remember this? I had a good childhood. Yeah, so I went to Enrico Fermi School. From Enrico Fermi, went to Emerson Junior High School. And then from Emerson went on to Saunders Trade and Technical High School. After graduating high school, then I went on to college. I wanted to stay close to home, and I wanted to graduate without having any college debt. So I went to community college in the Bronx.
Okay, mm-hmm. That's cool.
Yeah.
Now, were you the first in your family to go to college, or?
First in my family to go to college, yes.
I'm sure your parents were pleased about that.
They were very proud. I remember when we got the acceptance letter, my parents were so excited. We wanted to celebrate, you know? And it was just one of many little milestones, you know? So it was incredible. It really was incredible. And then, it just let my parents just sort of celebrate the fact, wow, you know, all of our hard work, all of our effort, all of our love and dedication, here it is.
Mm-hmm.
Here it is coming into fruition. So, yeah, it was great. And, you know, and when I graduated college, it was more their degree, you know? I was like, here you go, guys. Because anything
right.
that I accomplish in life is yours,
right,
not
right,
mine,
right,
it's
right,
yours.
Because right.
I wouldn't be here if not for them.
Right.
Yeah.
So now you were bringing up your brother, now transitioning to what happened and what that took you.
So it's so hard. I could talk about it 1,000 times, and it still feels like
first time, like me.
Yeah. You know.
How old is he?
25, cancer survivor.
What was his name?
Martin Antonio Perez. Martin. And engaged to the love of his life. Brand new dad, had a 7-month-old little baby girl. He was so crazy in love with that little girl, and he couldn't wait to give her 7 days. And he was so excited to be a dad. I remember when the baby was born, they made us wait 3 days to reveal the baby's name. The whole thing was a production. The whole thing was a production. They made us wait 3 days for the big reveal. And you know, the minute I got the call that the baby was born, I left work. You know, I was like, my baby's born. And my colleagues were like, what is wrong with you? Because, you know, it's just like, and we used to even fight over the baby because I love her so much.
Right.
She looks just like her dad. So, incidentally, she looks like me because her dad and I look just alike.
Right.
So he used to tell me, go have your own kids. Give me back my baby. And so I used to tell him, you know, we're related, so my DNA is in there. So technically, she's half mine. Technically, she's half mine. So, it was just one of the best memories I have of her. So my brother Martin, my younger brother, by 3 years, my younger brother, my only brother, like I was saying, he's a cancer survivor, engaged to the love of his life, brand new dad. And I remember actually when he had the cancer, he had this tumor growing in his chest, and he had to go through surgery to remove the tumor. And then very shortly after, immediately after, he had to go through both chemo and radiation therapy as well. So it's really difficult to see somebody you love and so young go through something so hard. I remember him running home. My father would bring him home after getting the chemotherapies or the radiation therapies, especially the chemo. He would run upstairs and go straight to the bathroom just to get sick, you know, because it makes you, it's poison. Yeah, it's poison to kill another poison in your body. So it was hard. It was really hard seeing him go through that. And then I remember him, you know, and then it was especially hard actually, you know, like his body was trying to stay strong, and then he started to lose his hair. The whole thing that happens when somebody's going through those kind of treatments. But then when he started to feel a little better, he tried to see the upside of it, and he tried to deal with the illness with humor. So I remember in finding some of the home videos, he was sorting out his medication, and we're telling him to say something for the camera, and he'll laugh. He said, I got cancer, and he'll start laughing, but I'm beating it, and he'll start laughing, you know? So, and he did. He beat it. We were so excited. We were so happy. And he had to wait a little while before he had children, obviously. And the minute he got the clear, there came my little niece. Immediately, he couldn't wait to start his family. So the baby came immediately, and it was just another reason for him to celebrate, you know, a second chance at life. You know, being a dad. So, So it was another chance for him to, you know, just to celebrate, and just to feel another reason to be happy and to feel blessed, you know, to be here with us, starting a family and seeing, you know, seeing a little piece of love, you know, just come to life. And so he, wow, it was so hard. He was actually going through the paperwork and getting ready for the test because he wanted to be a youngest firefighter. And he was working at a job, and he picked up for the holidays in December 17, 2007. He picked up a side job at a local diner here in Southwest Yonkers. It was called the Emerald Diner. And they do 24-hour deliveries and stuff like that. So it was just for the holidays. He wanted to make some extra money just so that he can buy extra presents for his baby girl for Christmas, because it was going to be her first Christmas. And he wanted that tree to be filled under the tree. He wanted nothing but presents for his baby. So it was only supposed to be for like 2 weeks, really. And just a few days before Christmas, we were at a funeral home saying goodbye to my brother. Because it's hard. So you sort of get used to living with the pain, but it still doesn't get easier. So one day he went into work, And that day, he actually wasn't feeling well. You know, he was coming down with a cold. He was feeling a little feverish, and he laid down for a nap. And you know, he asked my mom to give him a wake up call, and my mom called and called, and he didn't wake up. And eventually, he did. He went to work. He's like, I don't know. I just don't feel well. I don't feel right. But because he has such a good work ethic, he went to work anyway. He's like, I don't feel well. I even have a fever, but I'm going to work. I said I was going to go, and I'm going to work. And he went to work, and it was the first call they gave him for delivery. Some young gang members, they thought it'd be really funny to place a bogus delivery call with a sole intention of robbing and harming the delivery person. Now, I don't know who in the right mind can do that, because what kind of money, first of all, what kind of money do you think a delivery person is carrying out? And that's first of all. Second of all, why? Somebody, this person's working. This person's working to earn a living. This person, you know, it's not out there in the street causing problems, trying to rob someone else. And my brother was a law-abiding person. He wasn't out there in a gang. He wasn't out there in a club starting a fight or any. He was working to provide for his family. And so they attacked him, and when they had no idea that someone like my brother was going to show up. My brother was 6 foot something, pure muscle, you know, very fit. My brother was trained in hand-to-hand combat and everything, and then they couldn't subdue him. You know, my brother had no idea that those young teenagers had a loaded gun. So they couldn't subdue him. My brother, you know, defended himself. They couldn't subdue him, and they just took out a gun and shot him point blank. And they just ended his life in an instant. And the way the wound was, it was. I hope that what the medical examiner told me, I hope it's true. She said that he wouldn't have even known what happened because it was that instant. You know, and I can only hope and pray it's true. You know, I remember just having so many dreams with him. And in the dreams, you know, I would run to him and I would touch his face. And I would check his face, you know, for the bullet wound and everything. And I would ask him, are you okay? Are you okay? And he'll say, I'm fine. And I would tell him, where are you? Mom and Dad are looking for you. And he'd say, I'm okay. I'm here. And then I would wake up and I would go crying because no, he's not here and no, things are not fine. So, I remember when I got the call, I was at my company's Christmas party and one of my colleagues had just lost his mother. And then, you know, and I'm giving this person condolences because this is what we believe, this is what we need to do, condolences, you know? So I'm giving him condolences and then I get the call, you know, and it's just, after everything happened, I'm receiving condolences. And I was so angry because don't give me condolences. To me, this is what I believe. Condolences are for the dead, and my brother's not dead. So to me, I just pretend he's at work right now, or with his family right now, or something, but not dead. So I don't want to hear condolences because you're asking me to believe something that I still have a hard time believing. You know, so, so I get the phone call and I rush back to Yonkers and you know, I remember seeing a lot of missed calls and I'm calling back and his friends are telling me, you know, something happened, he was shot in the head, he's dead, and I screamed. I was like, what are you talking about? I remember because my brother was a big prankster. And I remember saying, put my brother on the phone. This is not funny. Tell him this is in really poor taste. Put him on the phone, please. And his friend would say, no. I'm serious, this really happened. And I remember screaming, put him on the phone. And when he would not put him on the phone, I hung up on him. My sister called, and I remember my sister was crying so hard, I thought she was laughing. But she was actually crying so hard. And I remember yelling at her saying, this isn't funny. I mean, how can you pull this prank, you know? And it took me a minute to realize that she was actually crying. And I asked her, where mom and dad? And she said they were sleeping. And I told her, lock yourself in your room. Just be quiet. Do not wake them up. I'm on my way back right now. I called the job and I asked them, where's my brother? And one of his colleagues answered the phone, a young woman. And she said, look, I'm sorry. You know, the police found the body. And I will never forget how I yelled at this girl. And I called her all kinds of names because I remember telling her, you are so stupid. Stop. What body are you talking about? Stop with this prank. Because I really thought it was a prank. You know, stop. And I prayed it was a prank. You know, and I remember telling her, what body are you talking about? I don't know what you're talking about. Put him on the phone. And I called his number, and there was no answer. So I rushed back to Yonkers from Midtown Manhattan. I don't know how in the world I made it here safely. I don't know how I didn't get pulled over, how there was no traffic, how there was no construction, how I didn't get into an accident. I got here like in 15 minutes. I have no clue how I did that. And I went straight to the building where it happened, 15 Coffin Avenue. And it's crazy because just a few days before it happened, I remember having this dream that I was standing up under the building and I was crying my eyes out. And on one side I could see the back of ShopRite, and on the other side I remember seeing the building, and I remember crying in this dream, but I didn't know why. And that night when I ran over there and I was crying in front of the building, there it was. It hit me. And I remember thinking, oh my God, this can't be real. And I saw the car that he was driving to make the deliveries parked in front of the fire lane with the blinkers on. And I looked inside the car, and all the other deliveries that he was supposed to make were still in the car. And still in my head, I kept telling myself, oh, this is such an elaborate prank.
Wow.
Yeah, still in my head, because denial is so powerful.
Yeah.
And especially when it comes to a tragedy like that. So I go in, you know, and obviously the cops are there, the techs are there, and they wouldn't let me inside. You know, they wouldn't let me in the stairwell. And I kept asking, was my brother? And I remember one of the cops asking me, are you related to the victim? And I instantly hated that word.
Victim,
are you kidding me? Victim, because that implies that he was overpowered. You know, that implies that somebody had the power to take his life. Somebody had the power to do something to him. So I immediately hated that word. You know, and I'm like, and I remember replying, I'm Martin's sister. Like, you know, saying his name. I'm calling him victim. You know, I remember saying his name, and I kept saying, I need to talk to him, you know, where's my brother? And they were like, you need to come with us. But I'm like, no, I need to talk to him, because obviously something happened, he must be confused, I need to see him, what hospital is he in? And they wouldn't say anything, they were like, you need to come with us. And it was, I had left my car in the middle of the street, and cops everywhere. So one of them took my car, and they took me with them back to the station, and they put me in the little room in the back. And, you know, they told me, look, you know, something happened, you know, he was a victim of a crime, and you know, he's gone, and he was shot, and I remember saying, no, you're wrong, like, you know, you're wrong, it can't be my brother, you need to take me to him. And I remember I started describing my brother to the T, because they told me, you know, they found the body in the stairwell and stuff like that. And I said, I don't know what body you found, but you need to give that family my condolences, because that's not my brother. And then I started describing him to the T. You know, he's yay high, has yay features, you know, the scar from his surgery, and, you know, and this kind of tattoo, and this and that, and in hopes that they would tell me, okay, well, that's not the description of the body we found. But that was not the answer I got. You know, and when I didn't get the answer I wanted, I remember saying, like, you don't know how to do your job. You know, because again, denial will not quit, you know? So, and when I got to the house, my parents were awake already, you know, and they say they woke up because they heard my sister crying. So they woke up from her crying. And then we went back to the restaurant, we're trying to get answers, but you know, and still we kept telling ourselves, there's so much confusion, he's in a hospital somewhere. So I told the detectives, you know, you need to take me to him. And they didn't know how to find any other way to explain to me, we're gonna take you to him, but we're not taking you to a hospital, you know? So early in the very next morning, we went to the morgue. And I couldn't, there's no way on earth I was gonna let my parents identify him.
I had to do that.
Yeah, there was no way on earth. So I had to go identify him. And, you know, they bring you in and this, it's sort of like a small hallway, and there's this wall, and it's a half glass wall, and you see a small room, and it's all white, there's nothing in it, and just a door at the very end. And then the door opens, and someone comes in pushing you know, this, you know, this table, like the slab, and you can clearly see there's a body underneath a white sheet. And they bring it very close to the glass, and they wait for you to be ready, and then they pull the sheet back, and you obviously have to identify the person. So when they pull the sheet back, you know, it looked like him, but I couldn't say yes to that. Because to me, that lifeless body cannot be my brother. So when they asked me, is that him? You know, my answer was no. So there was some confusion because I couldn't identify him. So I said no, you know? So it was his fiance's sister who made the ID because I could not say yes to that. To this day, I would not say yes to that. And every time that image comes into my head, I replace it with something from my childhood. So, it was one of the most difficult things I've ever had to do in my entire life. And then, you know, like me being the oldest child, you know, my brother who always comes to me for answers, my parents, everyone comes to me for answers, for everything, you know. Something's going on, I'm gonna fix it. I'm Mrs. Fix-It, you know, in my family. And so I try so hard to like make the funeral arrangements because I didn't want my parents to deal with any of that. And I couldn't, I just broke down because I was supposed to be helping my brother plan his wedding, not a funeral, you know, so I just couldn't. Like a very close friend of mine had to step in and take care of that. And I have never in my entire life felt so useless because I couldn't stop what happened to him. I could never predict what was going to happen. I couldn't prevent it. And I can't fix that. So I remember the pain being so heavy that I couldn't lift my head. You know, and there were cameras everywhere, there were reporters everywhere, because the whole thing was very public because of how it happened and when it happened. Exactly. And I remember I couldn't lift my head. The pain was so heavy. And when I got back home, there were so many people in the house. I don't know where all these people came from. And, you know, the door opened. I went back to my parents' house. The door opened, and the first people I see was his fiance, you know. She had the baby in her arms, and my parents. And then there were so many people. To me, they looked like shadows. And when that door opened, it was so quiet in their apartment. It was so crazy because their apartment was so crowded, but it was so quiet. You could hear a pin drop because they were just waiting for my answer. And I couldn't say it, so I shook my head no. And everybody started screaming at the same time. Like, you know, I remember the screams, and it was just like, and again, I felt like, you know, I kept saying I'm sorry to my parents because I can't fix this. You know, so it was just, it's really difficult, but, you know, I instantly stepped in, you know, and, I mean, no one can replace him, and I instantly stepped in and became like, you know, like the dad he would be for my niece. Yeah, so, you know, she's my little niece and also my goddaughter, and I made sure that she was taken care of, you know, her father died trying to provide a good life for her. And I make sure that, you know, that everything that he will do, would, you know, if he were here, I do for her. And she's such a beautiful, smart, witty little girl, you know. And as she was getting older, she would ask a lot of questions, obviously, like every child does. And we would tell her, you know, your dad is in heaven. And, you know, there was one time my sister bumped into a friend of his. And they were having a conversation, and then she asked him, "Didi, who is that?" And she said, "Oh, that's your daddy's friend." Oh my God, and this little girl's answer, she said, "Well, that's his friend? If he's here, then, like, why can't daddy come here, you know? Like, and we will tell her, he's in heaven." And she would say, "Well, can he get permission to come here? His friend is here." It's just, you know, and we will show her, like, home videos. And she, like, this is when she was much younger, and she would look at the TV, and she would say, well, I see him here, but where is he? You know, and as she started to, you know, get older, you know, she's learning to understand more, but she doesn't know the full details yet. We have all the newspaper clippings and videos and things like that, so when she's ready, or when we think it's an appropriate time, then we will show her those things. We will give her more details and everything. But from the very young age of two, you know, she's been out there with me in the community, knocking on doors, you know, because I have never been so angry in my life, you know, like from that time, from the time of like losing my brother and the way I lost him. I've never been that angry, and I'm still angry. You know, I can't bring him back, I'm still angry. So, what I did was, you know, I played a very active role in catching the people responsible, you know, and helping people come forward because they have this whole, you know, see nothing, say nothing. Exactly. So I went out there, I went knocking on doors, I was begging people, please come out, please talk to the police, please help me catch the killers and so forth and so on. And people came out. People participated, you know. And thanks to my community, you know, we were able to catch my brother's killers. The accomplice was given 10 years for cooperating with the authorities. And then the trigger man, the shooter, is now serving, actually. You know, he was sentenced to 22 years to life, and he is serving that sentence currently. And how else can I thank the community for helping me? I got some form of justice, because a lot of families go without getting any type of justice. I got just some form of justice. So how else can I thank you for that? So I decided to surf. You know, sadly, it took a tragedy, you know, to get me out there. You never think in a million years that this is going to happen to you. You never think, you know, that, oh yeah, that happens to, you know, you see that in the news. It happens to people that you don't know, or people that you may know, but it doesn't affect you as much because it wasn't your loved one. Never think the tragedy is going to knock on your door, and when it does, you just don't know what to make of it, you know? And you don't know what to do with yourself from that point forward. So what I did was, in an effort to to sort of feel like he's still here and to keep him alive somehow, and sort of to stop thinking about the pain, keeping myself busy doing something positive to honor his memory, that pain, that loss, that anger motivated me, propelled me into a life of public service. Because I was already out there knocking on doors, asking people to come forward and to help, and they did. I needed to repay them. I needed to repay my community. And so I decided to serve my community and do everything in my power possible to prevent this from happening to someone else and to help improve our quality of life here in South West Yonkers. So I became a public servant, and I express myself as far as my constituency goes. I talk about my constituents as if they were my extended family, because to me they are. You know, they're not constituents, they're not voters, they're not just residents. They're my extended family. I have a very small family here. You know, my brother, who's no longer with us, his baby, my mom, my dad, and my sister, you know, and my brother's fiance. That's it, there's only like six of us. You know, my like extended family, you know, it's my seniors, my youth, my hardworking mothers and fathers, people who came out there to support me, and they continue to support me time after time after time, and I am eternally grateful for that, you know. So, and I say it, I will continue to serve them as long as God and my voters allow me to. In the future, should I ever lose any political election, I will never see that as a loss. I will see that as my constituents, my extended family, like I said, I will see that as them telling me, thank you, your debt has been repaid, you can go back to your own life now. You know, so, and that's what I've been doing from the bottom of my heart, you know, it's a mission to keep my brother alive somehow. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, yeah. So you talk a lot about Southwest Yonkers. Well, people that don't maybe know, what's up with Southwest Yonkers? Tell us, what's so special about that community?
Well, we all know that Yonkers is the fourth largest city in the state. Southwest Yonkers in particular is one of the most primary areas. You know, we have all this senseless violence running rampant through our streets. And Southwest Yonkers is the portion of all the tree named streets, B Street, Oak, Maple. We do have portions of South Broadway, we have portions of Riverdale, Linden, Ludlow,
Lawrence,
Elliott. I love that street. I love the way those buildings look. And unfortunately, it's plagued by crime, criminal activity. A lot of young people who really don't
have a positive outlet or somewhere else to turn to, somewhere else to express their creativity or anger, whatever that is, express it in another manner instead of destroying your own community, you know, instead of destroying your own life and perhaps the lives of your would-be victims. So I do everything. I get out there, I knock on doors, I talk to them out on the street, I talk to the parents, I volunteer at the jail, and I go in there and I talk to the inmates and let them know, look, there are consequences for your actions, and in particular when they are just terrible consequences, like, you know, resulting in someone's death, like my brother's death, and you cannot undo that. Believe me, I'm trying to figure out how to undo that, and I can't. So, and if you're the one who committed the crime, you cannot undo that. You don't have to live with that forever. And I try to explain to them the consequences of making permanent decisions based on temporary situations. You know,
I love that. My mother used to always say that.
Yeah, yeah. Never make a permanent decision based on the temporary situation. Yeah. And when I go in there to volunteer, a lot of those young men in there are from here, from my community, from Southwest Yonkers. But then they can't tell, you know, and I give them that tough love kind of thing because, you know, I they cannot give me that excuse that, well, you don't know where I come from. No, I know exactly where you come from because we were next door neighbors.
Right.
We were granted the same exact opportunities. I know what I did with mine. What did you do with yours? There are no excuses. There's no back door. There's no way out. You have to take full responsibility for your actions. And this is what happens. Now, you still have time to redeem yourself. Are you willing to? Yeah, and I've been doing it for years. I've been doing it for close to 6 years. And so far, so good. I get great feedback from the inmates themselves as well. And so it's just, I try to figure out every way possible to contribute, to give back, and to make some positive changes come about. This is a direct correlation between crime and education. So even though Washington County government has nothing to do with schools, I still make it my business to play a very active role in delivering to our kids. We deliver supplies, like I said, deliver supplies to schools, to the kids, to even outside of my own district. I get kids who are in need because all they need is a little helping hand. That's all they need, and some motivation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I heard they was using that for an Oreo commercial.
They are. Yeah. Isn't it awesome?
Yeah. I was thinking about that. I was like, oh, they got Biggie playing in here?
Yeah. It does. Right now I saw it. I'm like, oh, wow.
Anything I didn't ask you that you want known?
Not that I can think of. Maybe some of my legislative priorities or something. I mean, like I said, when I first ran for office, I ran on a public safety platform. But eventually, you know, going into the task of governing, your platform grows and evolves, and you become more aware of things that are happening in the community. Because when you first come in, you're getting your platform from your community. They're telling you what the problems are, and you're going to work with them to come up with the solutions. So aside from a very public safety platform, which will still remain the same, there are other things, you know, quality of life issues, passing fiscally responsible budgets, budgets that allow us to keep taxes at bay, but still continue to deliver essential services to our community, bus transportation, senior services, youth services, childcare services, and continue to pass bond acts and legislation and PLA projects that support our men and women in our unions, working on improving the wastewater treatment plant in Lulu, which a lot of people know it as the sewage treatment plant, working on energy efficiency projects, helping to save the environment at the same time, helping to save taxpayers' dollars. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so much. Mm-hmm. You know, there's so much that goes into the task of governing. There's outside, which is when I'm out there in district doing all the exciting stuff, like people will say, but then there's behind, not behind closed doors, but office work, paperwork, negotiating, working on budgets, working on particular, language or particular legislations. We just passed the Immigrant Protection Act, but the county executive vetoed it, so we're going to continue to work on that because it was an act, we have to the end of the term to do that. We're working on the drag racing legislation we passed.
Do you think you got enough to overturn the veto?
There's hope, you know. The good thing is that they are having conversations with you, with us. We do have an open dialogue with the administration, with my colleagues across the aisle. They are willing to talk, they are willing to work something out. Should we end up with something that works for both sides, time will tell. We do have to the end of the term to do that.
Now, I've heard, and this will be my last question, I have to do with, now you're a Democrat?
Yes.
But I heard that you're, what would be the right word? I don't want to say porn.
Just say it, say it.
You're porn for the Republicans, you know, like you're the Republicans, like, you know what I'm saying? Like you're a Democrat name only or something, like.
Nonsense, yeah. Absolute nonsense. I'm a full-blown Democrat, but I'm a fiscally conservative Democrat. I'm an independent Democrat who's not afraid to stand her ground. As long as I know that I can deliver for my community. I am loyal to my constituents and my constituents only. Not to party bosses, not to special interest groups, my constituents only. And as I, they've been saying those things about me for years now. They've been knocking on doors and bad-mouthing me, you know, painting me in such a terrible light. My community knows it's nonsense. They know it's not true, which is why they continue to support me.
Mm-hmm. I need you to do one thing. Mm-hmm. I need you to, this one got jelly on it.
And I forgot to mention, we passed the synthetic drug ban a few months ago. Very proud of that.
Thank
as well.
Thank God.
Yes, we passed the synthetic drug ban as well. There's so many pieces.
I worked with Keith Olsen to get him out of Yonkers.
Yeah.
I even found out where in the Bronx they had.
Get out.
Yeah. I told them where the warehouse was, and they were shipping it in to Yonkers at 8 o'clock at night in different stores.
Jesus.
I got involved with the bodegas, they were selling them. I told them where it was. I mean, I even went to the Bronx and bought some from the place
Yeah, they have these bodegas and they have all these things in these packages that make it appealing to the youth, mm-hmm. and they just start mixing the ingredients and come up with some concoction that when
and then everybody turns into a zombie.
Exactly, when they have a terrible reaction to it, because they do.
And they have something out of potpourri or something or whatever they was doing.
Yeah.
Potpourri,
yeah.
Scooby Snacks, K2, I mean, you name it. Synthetic marijuana, by the way.
People get messed up in Valhalla. It was like, where's it coming from?
It's crazy. Well, the synthetic marijuana, for example, they think is, they'll smoke it because it's marijuana. Synthetic marijuana, it is not marijuana. It is plant-based laced with all kinds of chemicals and substances that are not meant for human consumption. So, and that's where they have the reactions that they do. It's insane. It's insane the things that people do. Hi, I'm Westchester County Legislator Virginia Perez, representing the 17th District Southwest Yonkers. Please find me on the September issue of Black Westchester, which is National Hispanic Heritage Month. I'm looking forward to hearing from you guys out there. Please call me if you need to speak to me, even if you don't need to speak to me, if you want to say hello, if you want to see me knocking on your neighborhood, knocking on your doors. My number is 914-995-2846. Email me at Perez@westchesterlegislators.com or friend me on Facebook. It is the easiest and fastest way to stay in constant communication with everyone out there in the community. Again, this is Virginia Perez, and I look forward to seeing you guys out there. Don't forget to check out the September issue of Black Westchester. Thank you.